We keep being told that AI is going to replace many professions, from developers to project managers and architects. Yet here we are in 2025 and we all still have our jobs. It turns out that while general purpose models like Gemini and Claude are good at many things, they are not experts in any specific field. That is why we have seen a boom in new AI development methodologies. You might have heard of SpecKit from GitHub, but today we are talking about one that came before it, the BMAD method. The core idea is simple but powerful. Give the AI specific roles or personas and guide it through a strict development process. You pass work from one specialized agent to another. This way, each one starts with a clean, focused context and can operate at its best. I've been trying out the BMAD method to migrate one of my own projects. In this video, I'm going to share my hands-on experience, the good, the bad, and the lessons I learned along the way. My project is a Slack bot, also named the Gray Cat. It's a mature and stable bot that I wrote in Go. The problem wasn't with Go itself, but with the Google package I was using, Generative AI Go, which is now deprecated. It didn't have a clear way to provide tools to the AI. The new industry standard is the Vercel AI SDK, so I decided to rewrite the bot using that. The bot has a few features. It replies to mentions, reacts to trigger words, and, most importantly, generates images of chunky British short-haired gray cats for any image prompt it's given. I wanted to migrate all these features and also give it new powers like searching our team's Notion knowledge base or reading readmes from GitHub. This felt like the perfect project to test out the BMAD method. So, what exactly is BMAD? Think of it as a framework for managing a team of AI agents. You have different personas, each with a specific job. First, you have your planning agents, the product manager or PM, and the architect. They work with you to create a detailed product requirement document or PRD and design the system architecture. There's also an analyst for market research, but this step is optional. Then you move to the development cycle. A Scrum Master agent takes the high-level plans and breaks them down into extremely detailed technical stories for the developer agent. Finally, a QA agent reviews the work to ensure quality. To get started, you run a single command, npx bmat method install, and go through a few configuration steps. This makes the agent commands available directly in your IDE. For example, in Claude code, you switch between roles using simple commands like PM or dev. Since I already had an existing project, I was doing what bmat calls brownfield development. I skipped the optional analyst and brainstorming part and went straight to the planning agents. First up was the product manager. I worked with the PM agent to create a brownfield PRD. This was a long interactive session. I explained my goals, feature parity with the old bot and migrating to the AI SDK. The PM asked many questions and produced a massive 442-line markdown file. It was incredibly detailed, covering everything from functional requirements to the specific environment variables that needed to be supported. Next, I switched to the architect. This is where I found my first major problem. The architect needed even more input. It asked questions, offered choices, and the conversation in my IDE just grew and grew. I was using the Opus model, but as the context window filled up, the responses got noticeably slower. I was worried it would ask me to compact the context and lose our progress. So for the last few questions, I just accepted its default suggestions to finish the process. The result? A nearly 1600-line architecture document. On paper, everything looked amazing. I had professional, deeply detailed documentation to start development with. The next step was to shard those huge documents, which is a BMAD process to split them into smaller files for the next agents in the line. Then I called on the Scrum Master, which created a detailed technical story. I switched to the developer agent and things started off smoothly. The initial code structure was good, but this is where the reality of AI development started to set in. After having a few stories implemented, I ran the linter. It failed. I cleared the context and asked the dev agent to fix it. It did, but then the test started failing. I asked it to fix the test, and it broke the linter again. It became a constant back and forth cycle just to get a clean build. At one point, the dev finished its work, and I called the QA agent. The QA came back and said, "Perfect implementation, amazing work." Then I tried to run the app. and it wouldn't even start. It was a comical moment that proves you have to verify everything yourself. As the codebase grew, the quality started to degrade. It began using any types all over the place as a shortcut for type mismatches it couldn't figure out. Some features were missing entirely, even though they were in the stories. I realized the stories were probably too large for the AI to handle in one go. I had to dive into the code manually to fix and refactor things. But it wasn't all bad. The code organization was quite good. I really liked how it handled pattern matching for trigger words in messages. For example, if a message contained cat, it would add a 20% probability of posting a reaction. The configuration management was also much cleaner than my original code. So, after spending several full days with this method, what is my verdict? First, the BMAD approach is genuinely promising. The way it forces you to create structured documentation is a huge step up from just one-shot prompting an AI to build this awesome feature. But to succeed with it, I learned a few crucial lessons. 1. The planning phase is everything. You cannot be lazy here. You must read every line the PM and architect generate and keep refining it until it's exactly what you want. This is where you prevent most of the problems later on. 2. Keep your stories small. If a story from the Scrum Master looks too big, ask for it to be split. A smaller task with a fresh context window will always produce a better, more intelligent result. 3. Verify the developer's work. Commit as often as you can. This lets you easily see the latest set of changes in a diff before they get mixed in with other work. After the developer agent says it's finished, review the code yourself before you test it or send it to QA. If you see it taking shortcuts, like using any types, ask the developer agent to fix them. If you don't, you'll end up with an unfamiliar codebase that you can't maintain. In the end, don't expect a magical new method to write a perfect app for you in an hour. It is still handwork, but the work shifts. Instead of writing every line of code yourself, you are guiding, reviewing, and course-correcting a team of AI agents. If you master this process, you can become incredibly productive. But it is not a replacement for a developer's job. It is a powerful tool that requires skill and diligence to use effectively. That's my experience with the BMAD method. Have you tried it or any other AI methodologies? Let me know down in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.